I have sort of two parts to what I want to talk about. And one of them is the idea that how Bhutan in current, which I think is suffering economically in the world as the whole world is actually, the United States very much so, and every other, even the miracle, so-called Chinese miracle, is slowing down. Indian economy is way down. And European, they barely saved Greece. And so it's no wonder that Bhutan is also doing that. So I have a rather long title, Happiness Empowering the Economy, and the need for, that's the one part, and then the need for scientific education in order to make Buddhist scientific education in order to maintain at home and deliver abroad profitably and sustainably health and happiness to a world in crisis full of people in panic. And don't think that they're not in panic, wherever it is. Anyone who becomes president of the United States, their hair turns gray within a few months. And some other leaders are perhaps different. But it's no easy business to try to lead the world or be in the world at this time. Okay, you can switch to the next slide. I'll just say next, yeah. So my main thesis in summary is that the challenge for Bhutan, in my humble opinion, and I must apologize for giving such an opinion since I really am a bit ignorant. I'm not my colleague Joseph Stiglitz, I'm not an economist, and my head is buried in texts that are at least 500 years old most of the time. But occasionally I take a look at the current scene as a grandparent and a great-grandparent and worry about the planet for my children. And when I come to Bhutan, I'm inspired at the possibility of the alternative that Bhutan could present to the world, although I think it's a very difficult thing to do. And the tendency would be, and certainly the people in the outer world, would be to wish to persuade Bhutan to join the rest of the world in the sort of industrializing growth frenzy and follow the rest of the world off the cliff of, consumerism and militarism, let's say. So what Bhutan should do, I feel, is to leverage the gross national happiness principle and practice to produce sustainable economic well-being and not to attempt industrial growth, quote, development, as the outer world is doing, which is unsustainable and self-destructive if the mainstream world does not change course as soon as possible. Our next slide. I want to agree right away with my friend and colleague Thongsa Rinpoche that happiness, quote unquote, is not the pleasure of the ignorant, unenlightened, egotistical person, totally dependent on circumstance. He has this book that I have on my shelf, but I haven't fully read, in which he says it's not about happiness. And it has a cover of a champagne glass or a martini glass on the cover, and it's like cool your jets about superficial happiness. So I agree with him that kind of pleasure of the ignorant and unenlightened, egotistical person, totally dependent on circumstance, is not the happiness of gross national happiness, or should not be the happiness, and it's certainly not the happiness that the Buddha announced to the world. Because, in fact, it's called in the Buddhist thought the suffering of change, because it included in suffering of the ignorant person, unenlightened person, because it never lasts, it changes into its opposite, and it's therefore never satisfying. But on the other hand, we can. So I agree with Rinpoche on that one, although I was a bit shocked when I saw his title, I must say. But on the other hand, we can define, quote, happiness, unquote, as the bliss of nirvana, freedom from suffering. You know, Buddha was conservative when he announced the Four Noble Truths about nirvana. He said nirvana means to be blown out or blown away, you know, or to blow out the flame of suffering is what nirvana means. Sometimes he called it nirodha, which means cessation of suffering. And so he was conservative, telling people who were miserable that he saw that it was possible for them to become free of suffering. He knew that for a lot of them, if he had just said it's impossible to be blissfully happy, they would be suspicious and they would not want to listen to him. Because no one believes there's such a thing as really durable, complete happiness that does never turn into its opposite. In fact, even some people who cling to their suffering, they say, oh, how boring to be blissful or happy all the time. That would be terribly boring. And they show that they really don't understand what it would be. So anyway, as the bliss of nirvana, freedom from suffering, which is the Buddha's great discovery and the foundation of Buddhism, as well that happiness is, or bliss, that bliss is, that freedom from suffering, as well, I believe, as the subliminal inspiration of the concept of gross national happiness. After all, what other great human teacher claimed that human life, when enlightened, can be utterly free of suffering? Next slide. In other words, even in the religious traditions, the theistic traditions, they never say, this is a veil of suffering, you know, the veil of misery, and we, you know, you have to suffer through it, the sinner, you know, and then God will save you later, and after death you might be okay if you belong to the right tradition and if you have the right faith. But that human beings could be free of suffering is not, nobody says that, other than the Buddha, really, basically, ultimately free of suffering. Freud, he said, I can help you with your neurotic suffering, and then when you're free of that neurotic suffering, you can get back to regular suffering. And healthy, have a healthy suffering. And that was Freud's idea. Now, just to run through the noble truths to back up that, what I'm saying, of the four noble truths, the first is the noble truth of suffering, which actually is part of what eventually Buddha describes as conventional or illusory reality. Not a complete illusion, but an illusory reality. The cause of suffering, his analysis of that, namely egotistical ignorance and delusion, is also conventional reality. Nirvana, freedom from suffering and bliss, is the actual reality. You know, ultimate reality means the actual reality, the real reality, let's say. So that third noble truth is the one that he really discovered to be the nature of reality. Therefore, that is why I say that the achievement of bliss or happiness is the foundation of his movement, of the Buddhist movement. Then the Eightfold Path, which is the fourth noble truth, is also conventional reality, although it is the therapy for the second noble truth, the cause of suffering, to remove suffering. And the Buddha's great discovery, therefore, is number three. You know, it doesn't take a Buddha to discover suffering. All you have to do is like break your leg or stub your toe or have, you know, somebody die or whatever. It's suffering is abundant, abundantly discoverable. But freedom from suffering is hard to find, and hard to anyone claim that they really found it. In a way, it's preposterous to the ordinary worldly mind. They sort of, you know, they think, well, Buddhism is a religion. It's sort of a nice thing. He had people believe, but people just don't believe that it's possible, really. So therefore, they basically are not very inspired. Even Buddhists are not really inspired to try to attain nirvana. They sort of think that, well, some people attain nirvana in Buddha's time. Buddha, I guess, attained nirvana. Maybe I can in a future life, but I wouldn't expect to do so any particular time, and therefore I have to just be resigned to suffering. That's most Buddhists feel that way as well. Freedom from suffering, of course, is bliss and happiness, and millions have attained it over the 2,500 years or 2,600 years of Buddhism. Guru Rinpoche, the Shabdrung, they all attained it, and Bhutan's culture is based on it, and therefore gross national happiness. Now here I thought I would just compare the branches of the Eightfold Path, which I didn't list. Actually, I could have had a slide, but I didn't list them, because you all know them by heart. The first one, of course, is what people often call right view. And I don't like right, because it's sort of like as if it follows a rule or follows somebody's order. But the branches of the Eightfold Path, I think Samyak is, or Yandak, is better translated as realistic. So I translate as realistic worldview, and that the realistic worldview that the Buddha taught was the worldview of relativity, causality, you know, Tendel, and of course the knowledge of which leads to nirvana. So that's his realistic worldview. So in other words, you don't have to make a huge like leap of faith or to adopt a realistic worldview. It doesn't mean adopting anything unreasonable or blind faith thing. It means simply being accepting of causality completely, accepting of relativity, accepting of being connected to everything in the world to a full degree, which we do not, nor the unenlightened person does not do. The unenlightened person accepts a certain level of causality, but they think that inside themselves there's a separated self, an absolute self that somehow is immune to that causality, and therefore they tend not to have realistic worldview. Now, does the outer modern world, with all its science and all its supposed knowledge and its universities and its philosophers, Does it have realistic worldview by that definition? No, it does not. The we or they have either an absolutist theism or dominant is a nihilistic materialism. And there is temporary causality. Now, there is a temporary causality in the miserable sinner's world of the absolutist theist. And then God, who is an absolute that acts relatively, somehow unrealistically, that an absolute can act relatively, lifts the soul out of the faithful believer. So there is not a full acceptance of causality, is my point. And therefore, from the point of view of realistic worldview, it's unrealistic. And they themselves say it's a blind faith issue. There's no, you know, don't think you can reason yourself to the existence of this absolute who will save your absolute soul, no matter what you've done, as long as you have the right belief. On the other side, we have the modern, so-called modern people whose theory is of reality, which we all somewhat imprisoned by, especially those educated in the West, and I'm afraid a lot of the younger Bhutanese educated in a modern so-called way, is that really, reality is really nothing. Nothingness is the foundation of reality. And there is no soul and no mind, only a brain, no consciousness that is really a thing, a continuum of its own. No future and no past life. And that life is accidental, it's a random, it's a meaningless, it's a purposeless, and so forth. And that is the view of the worldview of scientific materialism, very forcefully argued. It has its profits and so on. And it's not realistic from Buddha's point of view. To expect, for anyone to expect that you can become nothing is an unrealistic worldview from the Buddha's point of view. And from a traditional Bhutanese point of view, is an unrealistic worldview. Second, based on the branch two is realistic motivation about the way of living, how to live. Based on realistic worldview of evolutionary causality, one makes life purposeful and meaningful by using the precious human intelligence and compassion to evolve in a positive direction in this life and the future up to perfect Buddhahood or enlightenment. So that would naturally be a worldview when you fully accept that you are a causal being, therefore you are an evolutionary being, and your evolution is determined by what you do, which includes not only what you physically do, but what you verbally do and what you mentally do, then you become forced by that realistic worldview to take up a motivation of acting in a positive way and thinking in a positive way and speaking in a positive way because you have accepted the responsibility for shaping your own future existence. You don't think that somehow it'll just be nothing at some point, no matter how you just slough through it, and you don't think that someone else can save you by coming from some detached absolute, some absolutely other absolute, no matter what you do, just because you have an open mind of belief, and especially unreasonable belief, which tends to be weak, actually. Blind faith-based belief tends to be weak, which is why people who hold it are so busy trying to persuade other people to adopt it, because it makes them feel like, well, if somebody else also can believe that, my belief is stronger. Modern life, therefore, is ultimately purposeless. The people subliminally believe. So eat, drink, and be merry, make money, use everything up on the planet, be daring and reckless even, do whatever you can get away with. Theists are a bit better in that they're afraid of being punished by an omnipotent being, but ultimately, through their blind faith, they feel they can get away with it too, after their crusade, after their A-bomb, whatever they want to drop here, after their shock and awe. If they're righteous in a religious way, then the absolute will intervene, deus ex machina, and save them. So neither of them are fully responsible to their own evolutionary causality, is my argument. Branches 3, 4, and 5 are the ethical branches, and which are, you know, realistic speech, realistic evolutionary action, and realistic livelihood. And these ethical branches are there with the lip service in the modern world, but no real reason to observe them except for show. What I mean by that is, in the human rights people, I've met many times with them over the years, in that they always want to know, does Buddhism have an idea of human rights and all this, because mistakenly they didn't think so for a long time. Their scholars, Western scholars, thought that Buddhism was some kind of, in a way, they thought Buddhism was nihilistic, actually, and that Buddhist people thought the world sucks, And therefore, the best thing is to just attain nirvana and get out of it and not be involved in it anymore. And the statement by the great sociologist Max Weber of the early 20th century still holds in much of academia, where they say Buddhism is socially apathetic, was his famous expression. However, and therefore, they're very proud of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, as well they should be, and the rights of man in France in the time of Rousseau, proclaimed and so forth. The French are very proud about that. But the thing that is therefore awkward for them is that since those things were proclaimed, the Western cultures and societies and powers, you know, conquered the entire world, committed all kinds of genocides, and behaved in a completely non-human rights-oriented manner. And so, in other words, they didn't, along with the theory, there wasn't really a reason once you didn't have connection to causality, you had some way to have some absolute skipping out of causality, there was no reason to really observe human rights except to uphold it as a wonderful theory. There was no real reason affecting you. You know, you could just get out of the consequence of whatever you did. However, in the Buddhist biological theory, and this is something maybe I innovate in saying, but I think it's arguably defendable, karma is not a mystical, religious sort of blind faith, oh gee, karma did something. It's not fate. Karmic theory is a theory of causality, and it's an evolutionary theory of causality, and it is a biological theory of causality. It is the Buddha's way of accounting for the differences of our life, like why are we the way we are, each individual, why are we human and not an animal, why are we not this and that, or we could become that if we behave that way, and it has to do with we are caught in the mind is involved in evolution, in other words. It's a very close to Darwinian theory, actually, in the sense that it shows the connection of the human and the animal and then various other life forms. But the difference, of course, with the neo-Darwinian scientific materialist theory is that the mind is part of evolution, and the human mind evolves. And the human mind, in a way, controls the evolution, not the human mind, the animal mind, anybody's mind. And so if you added a mind as hopping from gene carrier to gene carrier, in addition to the genes hopping along, if you added a mind that was hopping and was causally efficacious, then that would be the karma theory, biological theory. And I think when the materialist science realizes that it has been trapped in a dogma, in a blind faith dogma of materialism, and they bring a mind back into consciousness, back into a field of scientific study, they will find karma as one possible theory. Of course, it's not the absolute truth. No Buddhist theory about relative reality is the absolute truth, only relative truth, and that which is another important point in Buddhist hermeneutics. So anyway, in the biological theory of karmic evolution, the branches of the tenfold branches of skillful or unskillful evolutionary action, the Gewe Lam or Migewe Lam Chu, Gewe Lam Chu or Migewe Lam Chu, Gewa translating Sanskrit Kushala, which means skill actually rather than virtue, i.e. action that shapes one's future, there is a scientific reason to be ethical, and one who understands this can easily internalize ethical code as having the element of enlightened self-interest. That is, you behave well, you speak well, you think well in order to have a better future, at least for yourself, as well as if you can take the next step to be of benefit to others. And that is an evolutionary effort that underlies those branches of ethics in the Eightfold Path. The sixth one, the creative evolutionary effort, or, you know, avidya, zendru, the key here is to avoid despair, cynicism, and depression. And it's not merely the antidote to laziness, although that's the traditional way it's explained. But the attitude is that what really prevents people from exerting effort in positive evolution, in positively turning their life toward a very positive direction, body, speech, and mind, is the attitude, and turning the world in such a positive direction, is the attitude that it doesn't matter ultimately. So why bother? And it won't work. You know, the biggest cause, for example, I personally feel very strongly that the biggest cause of the modern outer worlds not stopping carbon emissions, which they know very well, except for a few, you know, the polluters, of course, hire some fake scientists to pretend that it's just a theory, and there's no real evidence that Greenland is melting, the Himalayas are melting, the polar ice caps are melting. You know, that's just fake. Everybody really knows that we're melting the ice caps, and we're looking to major destruction on the planet very soon. I think, what is it they say, we're 5 years past, we're 20 years past the worst case analysis given 5 years ago or something like that. They have, people have such theory, such calculations, you know. The IPCC, the International ICCP Climate Change Committee or whatever it is. So the biggest cause of the modern so-called outer enlightened, developed outer world, not outer from Bhutan, I'm saying, not stopping carbon emissions and not shifting from militarism to arts of peaceful creativity, is the idea that it won't help, that nothing works, that life is impossible, and that the problem is just solved for the individual by dying and becoming nothing and having an endless sleep, never mind whether things get flooded and Bangladesh goes underwater and whatever happens doesn't matter, because anybody who dies, once they die, then they're gone and it didn't have any meaning in their life anyway. And that is the depressing thought of modern materialism, and it is why people are reckless in relation to the planet that we live on, the climate. It's that cynical view that why should I do anything, because it really won't help. It's like in America today, I think almost 40, sometimes 50% of the people don't vote in elections because they think all the politicians are no good. There's no real difference between them. So why should I bother to cast, even do that little bit of effort, make that little bit of effort to move toward the positive? So the cynicism, you know, is really deadly. Now, finally, branches 6 and 7, which are mindfulness and smriti, you know, and samadhi, mindfulness and concentration, based on the realistic worldview, commitment, and ethical stability, the individual realizes the necessity of bringing the mind under control. Because when you realize that what you think affects your future evolution, not only what you physically do or verbally do, but even what you think, then you really have to, you can't just settle for having an unconscious filled with negative impulses and just get your psychiatrist to help you sort of channel them or vent them in some way where you don't act on them. But rather, you have to go in and clean them out. You have to go down into your unconscious. You can't be driven into future life by an out-of-control unconscious. Now, if you compare modern life to a realistic life, modern life involves addiction to television, to internal impulses coming out of absolute self, a sense of absolute self. You know, when someone feels, I have to be angry, or I have to have that object, or I have to shop for this, or I have to say that to them, or I have to press this button or do that. They feel, when they hear themselves think that internally, they have to do it. They're victims of their mind rather than their mind is their own tool. They are the tool of their mind. And so, in modern life, people are like that. And to frustration, therefore, says dissatisfaction, anxiety, and stress. And we all know it. And those who have the mass of 1 in 7 Bhutanese today who have moved here into the city, leaving the villages, supposedly the backward life of the villages, come to the modern stressed life. They're already involved, and they're all understanding, I think, the youth I'm talking, of course, especially frustration, dissatisfaction, anxiety, and stress. And since it is taught that you don't have a mind by modern science, they assure you from MIT, Harvard, any place, that you don't really have a mind. You just have a brain. You're just running around carrying this brain. The brain is making you like a robot, run around and carry it. You don't have a mind. And therefore, you can't possibly control yourself. And therefore, you need Prozac when you're stressed out. And you need this drug when you want to sleep. And you need another drug when you want to wake up. And it's just more material. You need to depend on them to control the material process that you are, helpless as you are. You know? I always laugh. In our core curriculum in our Western universities, I was at a college called Amherst College that thinks it's a very, very elite college. And has a very special core curriculum. And one of the key courses that people take is one called Darwin, Marx, and Freud. And supposedly, if you really get Darwin, Marx, and Freud, then you're really a modern person and you're really hip, you know. Then you can go out and, like, go to Wall Street and make a fortune. And in coming out of an elite college. But actually, if you look at the philosophies of Darwin, Marx, and Freud, Darwin would have you be the helpless victim of your genes. Marx would have you be the helpless victim of your position in society, and Freud would have you be the helpless victim of your unconscious, and therefore, bottom line, helpless. Therefore, join Goldman Sachs and make some money. Make some money, and never mind what effect it has on people, because you're just live, eat, drink, and be merry, and then die, and that'll be fine. And we'll take care of you also with better and better mind-altering drugs, right? So that's the modern life. But in the life that tries to live according to the Eightfold Path, that is to say, according to the refined national happiness or individual happiness, mindfulness, smriti, means really, the word means memory. And it means instead of ruminating in your mind as you're going around remembering things and removing yourself from what you're actually doing because you're lost in your memories, or being lost in your imagination and fantasies of future things that will happen to you, you bring your mind into the present and you see what your mind is doing and you start to gain control of your mind. And like I always like to say, if you develop a little mindfulness practice, basically even just breath counting and bringing your mind back to concentrate, even the slightest bit helps enormously, and it's like you realize that you can control your mind. You don't just have to follow every thought impulse to wherever it takes you. You learn to choose between the different thoughts in your mind. When a thought arises in your mind like, I've got to be furious because of this and that, and I'm going to lose my temper, and I'm going to destroy this or do that, then you can have another side of the mind can say, why is that? Who are you telling me to do that? You can talk back to yourself, and you can learn to control yourself. Like a person who has a clicker for their television. They don't have to watch that one channel without muting the commercials or switching the channel when some idiot is on the tube. If you had only a television set that only had one channel and you had to watch it all the time, that would be the state of a non-mindfulness person, unmindful person. Finally, samadhi, concentration, is needed to bring reasonable understanding of the self and life, which is developed by learning, by realistic worldview. And then meditation can join that realistic worldview. It's actually dangerous without the realistic worldview because that kind of concentration will only heighten the unrealistic worldview, which is why so many people who meditated for a long time jump up as gurus and behave egotistically. And people are so surprised because they meditated a lot. But that's because they were not combining that meditation with learning about the nature of the self and of reality. But once you do get some learning about that, then meditation is essential to drive that understanding deeper into your unconscious and making it truly transformative of your life. Okay, that's part one. Now, next part. Now, how the GNH principle empowers the new development of economy. So here, the question arises, how does real happiness, I'm sorry for my typos, I did this quickly, how does real happiness attract real wealth? And here, first, Bhutan has emerged worldwide as a global beacon of sustainable lifestyle, which, you know, we hope will not be disappearing under economic pressures. Foremost of all, and therefore it's inspiring to people all over the world, and it attracts people to come here, and the tourist income is not inconsequential, in fact, and that's one of the reasons. Foremost of all, to the Bhutanese themselves, therefore, as the first pillar of one kind of their important economic inputs, is the Bhutanese have the challenge to maintain their own real happiness. If they lose their happiness by being swept up in the demented pursuit of growth and development and industrial wealth, then they might very well, they will lose their happiness because the countries that are like that do have a loss of happiness. Bhutan, the miserable person cannot make others happy. Therefore, Bhutan must not become overdependent on outside economic forces because it will only result in its loss of its resources and then the individuals will lose their happiness. And then think, why do we love Bhutan? You know, we, the world, people of the world, and people in Bhutan too. Well, Bhutan has not only resources, but also values lost already by outsiders. The wealth of natural resources is extraordinary. The soil is not yet totally polluted by industrial chemicals, as our American soil is. Cancer is a big thing in America. And doctors are quickly trying to look for this virus and that virus. But actually, the cancer lives in the soil of America. Since the World War, they've been throwing chemical upon chemical into the soil, and pesticides, and also growth chemicals, and these things, and injecting the meat of the animals that they slaughter in a very, very unhumane manner, with all kinds of other chemicals to make money. And this goes into the people who eat it, and therefore cancer is in the very lifestyle, actually. It's not just something coming from outer space, some virus that came because they have longer lifespans because of whatever reason, because of public health things. but it's public health is not looking, therefore, at what the food industry is doing to the bodies of the American people. China is supposed to be a miracle, oh, wonder of wonders, a few hundred million people in a so-called middle class. I think really basically the money concentrated mainly in the elite, as it is in America, communist or not. And yet the soil there is also completely polluted. You know, the three out of the four elements, you know, soil, water, fire, and wind, the air. And the soil is polluted, the water is polluted, the temperature is excessive, and it's pouring carbon into raising the temperature of the planet and melting actually the glaciers at the root of the river systems that flow into China as well as here in Bhutan and India. And the air is unbreathable in most of the places. And so what kind of wealth do they have? Well, they have enough wealth to get out of there, actually. And I think the elite have a lot of bank accounts in China, in Canada, and in U.S., and in the British Virgin Islands, and in London, and everywhere. Because they can see it's not livable the way it is. They're talking about trying to fix it, and I believe, actually, they will. I don't want to preach doomsday. I actually think they will change and do it. But the point is that the materialist people with their distorted notion of development, pointing to it as a miracle at the moment, is not really realistic. Lots of money for the elite, but still mass poverty still exists there, and environment is ruined totally. A lot of internal violence, tension, and aggression in the society, basically very low on the happiness index. In the contemporary science of happiness, which has very much been stimulated by Bhutan, actually, you know that Joseph Stiglitz and Amartya Sen did a big study, you all know about it, for Sarkozy when he was president of France. And then there are sociologists in England and in America who are studying happiness. And in the study of happiness, China and America are down, way down in the list. China worse, much worse than America, but still way down. And, you know, the Norwegians, the Scandinavians, they're cheerful. And the Dutch, and I'm not sure where Bhutan hits, but probably still pretty good. But I forget where they list it from their studies. You know? Okay, so these values in Bhutan should generate a special economy, leveraging their traditional wisdom, but in a modern way. Take a spiritual industry. That is an industry, actually. You know, there's this whole thing about, you know, Dharma is for free and don't charge for it. But on the other hand, the monks come, even in ancient time, and they demand a free lunch. They come out with that begging bowl and they demand lunch. They want to be supported by the society. And actually, traditionally, the society has been happy to support them because they have added to the happiness value in India first and then all over Asia. They never conquered anybody to make them Buddhist. They had no such crusade. When there are more people becoming mindful, becoming less violent, dropping out, and when there's the place to escape from an oppressive family situation, etc., a place to seek education when you had no education in an agricultural, non-literacy promoting society, then they will go there. And the Buddhist monasteries and the monastic universities have thrived, therefore, as an industry. And here, if Bhutan's, already, I think, Bhutan example would be Gandhi Tukhu, who has many disciples abroad, Dzongzhar Khyentse Rinpoche, many, many disciples abroad. They don't bring them enough to Bhutan, perhaps because they haven't yet developed the kind of facility where they can keep them for a long period of time. I think only the people maybe who think they're ready for some three-year long retreat or something really drastic. But how about a one-week retreat, a weekend retreat, a three-week retreat, a one-month retreat? This would be economically a high value-added piece of industry, in fact. They would be, you know, it would be better than just driving up and down the roads. It could command a better market, and it would be very beneficial to many people. And which Bhutanese, either Lama or layperson, knows how to deliver that in large quantity? Who is being trained to do that? Dzongzhar Khyentse can go outside and deliver it, and so can Gandhi Tukhu and so forth, but very few. But there's no reason why it should be so very few. It's very possible that many others could learn to do that. And that would be a very important economic benefit to Bhutan. In a way, the spiritual side of Bhutan would have like a big begging bowl and get a lot of grants with no interest and no debt and no need for loans. And then, of course, it's a little tricky with the spiritual because the Dharma is free, you know, ultimately. It's available for everyone, should be. And the industry part only in making that availability easily accessible. and responsibly deliver it, actually. I like to say, you know, religion, I like to say that religions in general are service industries. They are, and their religions lose their religious and spiritual quality, and why a lot of people in the world today like to say, I'm not religious, but I am spiritual. It's a very common in the, any of the developed, in the sort of educated societies. And why they say that, because religions forget that they're there to serve their adherents. You know, religious people do. They get involved in the institution, and they think they own their adherents, and therefore they want to get bigger market share, and they compete with each other, and they fight with each other, and they create conflict, and they're intolerant of each other. But those are not really doing what the founders of the religions intended. The founders of religions intended to serve people, and any religion that has less is just serve them. In fact, I argue that Buddhism is less religion and more educational institution, and only adopted as a religion by people who in a way cannot access the educational service that is mainly what Buddhism is, which I'll come to later in the talk. Then second, the health industry. Bhutanese medicine, like Tibetan medicine, Ayurveda, and Chinese medicine, true traditional Chinese, not only acupuncture, but herbal and acupuncture, are actually becoming quite in vogue in the West, in worldwide, and they are connecting with herbalist traditions in the industrial societies, and then industrial medicine is beginning to develop some of its sort of more innovative and creative wielders of industrial medicine are beginning to look at a model of what they call integrative medicine, where there is knowledge about nutrition, about lifestyle, about mental things as connected to the physical body and so on, and there is a movement in that direction. The mainstream, of course, still of industrial medicine is commercial, and it is, you know, they were going to conquer everything with the genome project, and then they would, since you're just a gene carrier, they would fix you up, you know, with genes. I hope we're keeping up. Perfect, you're perfect. I forgot to say next, but thank you so much. You're very aware of what I'm doing. Thank you so much. And you know, so they would control everything about your life by understanding the gene. And of course, they found out that that was simplistic, and it's much more complicated. And then the psychiatrists are mad, the principled ones that I know, because they can only use the talking cure, the more spiritual side of psychiatry, with wealthy people, because the insurance companies will not pay for it, and they want them to give them some drug right away, anybody else, and they give these deadly drugs that have, you know, serotonin, and mess with the brain in ways that they do not understand, and they still trumpet it, though, as triumphal, and they're about to understand it, like they always say, but they actually are causing a big mess to a lot of people. And so, therefore, the Bhutanese-Tibetan medicine tradition, with both its natural botany based on thousands of years of experimental, trial and error and analysis. It's not just holistic; it's analysis of plants and plant powers, knowledge of nutrition, very thorough knowledge of the relation of ethical lifestyle and or unethical lifestyle and health, and the meditative side of it from the medicine Buddha. You know, Sanje Menla, is something of immense value. And Bhutan is perfectly positioned to develop an integrative by training people in that in a modern way to attract high value added health tourism like Thailand has. Thailand has it for industrial medicine. You go get surgery, dentistry. I do actually, and get away from the high prices in the Western countries and have excellent quality industrial medical service. But no country has emerged as the champion of the integrative medical thing. China is moving in that direction quite a bit with the popularity of acupuncture and the little bit less knowledge of herbal medicine. But they because of the communist thing, they don't have the spiritual side that the medicine Buddha thing has. So therefore, products derived from these two major industries that could be Bhutan's happiness-based industries, value-adding industries. You have herbal medicines, which could be distributed worldwide in a very properly marketed, not only just raw cordyceps as a raw material, but compounded in various ways to amplify and to balance its benefit. Not just letting someone come in and loot your cordyceps by bribing farmers across the border, but using it yourself and value adding it here with knowledge of traditional physicians and traditional pharmacologists to make that major production out of it, and do it in a sustainable way by not over-harvesting and so forth. Bhutan is well positioned to do that, and many other herbs that are really valuable. There's a Swiss company that is very successful, the Padma company, that uses Tibetan formulas, would be very happy, I'm sure, to work with such an industry here in Bhutan in helping the marketing in the West, you know, for example, worldwide. In Japan, it's huge. Actually, Tibetan herbal medicine is hugely profitable both in India and China, even though the one in India is validly and authentically done. The one in China is done in a big rush, unsustainably, but the mystique of the pure Tibet, the pure snowland, as they call it, is so huge in the polluted Shanghai and polluted Beijing that it's a very, very successful industry, and even without the spiritual element at all. And even though some of it is not well compounded, in fact, they just grind up some yak bones, for example, and give it to you for back pain. There's one big famous with making fortune doing that, even which is not good. It's not sustainable because it's not really well done, but with a good product, and with the good marketing, it would be a really big industry. And then another one is this pure, you have, I know, this nice Bhutanese spring water, which is, it's dew fresh. That's good. But if we gave that to some marketing advertising person, and you should be having Bhutanese young trained in advertising, it might not be, it has little press from the Himalayan kingdom of Bhutan. But to be, you know, they'd have in the West and worldwide, they have this Fiji water. And Fiji has no reputation of being a magical, mystical happiness island. I don't think so. But everybody has Fiji water everywhere because they have some aquifers that somebody bought. And the Fijians don't necessarily profit that much from it. But the Bhutanese can profit themselves from it very, very well if they learn to, and they can get out and compete with Fiji, Pellegrino, Evian, etc. Evian comes from a place in France where, you know, it's not that clean. The soil is not that clean. Pellegrino is pretty good from some mountain. You know, Pellegrino means pilgrim, so it has a little spiritual thing. And the Italians, you know, it's Italian, so it has the mystique of Italy, you know. But you guys have an even better mystique. Then organic agricultural products, and here I want to mention the wonderful project, again by Dzongkhar Khyentse Rinpoche, the Samdrup Dzongkhar project, or Gongkhar project, somewhere near Tashigang in the far southeast, where they're teaching village by village organic gardening, waste, zero waste management, appropriate technology, and youth engagement. I think that's quite marvelous. And that would be required to have Bhutan gain the international reputation that its marmalade or its apple jam or its apple juice is going to have some sort of special quality about it that will not be matched by those that come from polluted, you know, industrial agricultural processes. And that will then give you value adding to your agricultural production and not just become a resource provider, as happens, unfortunately, to countries that buy into the model of industrial development. I know here I mentioned this one, yeah. So the next slide, you know, our beloved Dzongkhar Rinpoche. And so Dzongkhar Rinpoche, now I'm moving to the section on supplementary education required. Our beloved Dzongkhar Rinpoche should be an archetype model for young Bhutanese, and not just because he's a Lama and a Rinpoche. He does teach, and he's capable of teaching traditional Dharma practice teachings, and he does so very well. But he also could develop, and he is training among his students, but they're mostly Westerners, unfortunately, but he should train whole cadres of Bhutanese who to be able to then man the retreat centers, the healing clinics, the health spas and things, and among young Bhutanese who come to him not to be lamas necessarily, some might be lamas, but, and not to just go off on a 20-year retreat or something and become Buddhas right away, although some might want to do that, or some might become Buddhas even quicker, but especially some of the women, I think, might, once they really had a good teaching. But because they're, of course, always quicker than the men. You know. I'm sorry, guys, but it is a fact. So in the West, the pillars of the Buddhist traditions, the Hindu traditions, the yoga tradition, how many people is Dzongkhar Rinpoche himself? I don't know if he teaches yoga, but there are people in his movement that do over in his center in Bir, and he should have a center like that here. And the young Bhutanese should learn to be yoga teachers. I have a son who's a yoga teacher, and he says, he's also an actor, And also he suffers the thing of not being Uma, which is, you know, difficult for in a sibling situation in a family. But he has a wonderful saying where he says, it used to be in New York that all unemployed actors were waiters and waitresses, and now they're all yoga teachers. And they have a better livelihood, actually, because it's yoga in America is a $20 billion business. And growing. So why not Bhutan? Why not someone being trained in Bhutan? Rinpoche can definitely set this up and do it, and I'm sure he will do so sooner or later. This Samdro Gongkhar project is a movement in that direction. On the spiritual side, it can be done, and on the health side, it can be done. And how does he do that? Now, how does a young Bhutanese become such a kind of person to leverage both spiritual and health values that are so integral to the Bhutanese and are part of the Bhutanese own individual and refined national individual happiness? How does such a young Bhutanese do that? What kind of education does he have? Is it just a religious education like a lama? No. It is a wisdom education, a scientific education through and through. It is the scientific side of Buddhism. All Bhutanese youth need that kind of education on top of that Western type of education that they do get, you know, from Indian high school and so forth format. They need that other kind of education as lay people, not monks or nuns, although some are welcome to follow such a traditional path. After all, I was told, and I hope that's correct, since I came here, that the median age of the country is now 22 years of age, and that 54% of the Bhutanese are under 25. So they need something new, a little bit. It's special, middle way, not just new in terms of, you know, materialist modern education, but that's also necessary to know, but also a kind of adapted Dharma education that is adapted to the layperson and what they call teacher training in the yoga world, not just the learner and not just, well, you should learn, and then if you're really serious, you go up in the mountain and stay up there for 10 years, which, of course, will not so much add to the gross national happiness. I mean, it will add to gross national happiness by radiating out good vibes, but it might not be economically too helpful. So next slide. Every Bhutanese youth should have instruction in the Buddhist sciences of mind. Entrepreneurs should develop medicine Buddha spa resorts, for which they need to train many young people in the arts of healing, theory of Ayurveda, the Guzhi medicine, Menla medicine, massage therapy. Some of them will not all be doctors. Some of them will be massage therapists, sports therapy. You know, then people can come and train for sports therapy and, whatever different sports there are. They can do altitude training here, like people go to Colorado to train in altitude. Nutrition. You know, industrial medicine in medical school, Columbia Medical School, they get like one class hour of nutritional training in four years of medical school. They don't know whether you should eat spinach or datsi, emadatsi. They wouldn't know whether you should eat emadatsi or like chocolate pudding. It makes no difference to them. They think that's just all nothing compared to the powerful industrial medicines. So they don't realize that medicine, which we know, and all of you Bhutanese know that, the first line of medicine or poison is your diet. Right? And you all eat this great diet, a lot of emadatsi to help you digest the yak meat, and which are from healthy yaks, I hope, not injected with anything. So yoga instruction even, you know. So that's what your entrepreneurs should be doing here. Rather than trying to build factories and trying to compete with Calcutta and Ranjitpur, whatever it is, Rangapur, those places, and get polluted like them. That would not really be the direction. But this kind of industry will be really beneficial to Bhutan, and the people delivering this will be happy, because people who do deliver this kind of service that improves people's happiness and health are happy in delivering it. So also the botany of medicinal herbs, how to cultivate, harvest, find them in nature, harvest sustainably for products. The wonderful thing about this kind of industry is that young Bhutanese would have to learn the values of their own culture in order to deliver them for a sustainable and yet profitable livelihood to the world as it comes here, you know, and to themselves and to the world as it comes here. So then one last thing, and my friend Drukpa Kunle, the community, which I think is where he's working on, which is so important, and the country has to be wired in the most modern way so that young people in villages can access global information and network and feel connected to the world in every without leaving their village. So there's more motivation to find, to develop and find a modern, natural, balanced life without leaving the parents bereft in the villages with a labor shortage and come to an unemployment situation in an overcrowded urban center where there is no industrial base to support them, nor will there likely be. Without it becoming something done by outside people, all the money coming from outside and all the money going back outside. So why submit yourself to that? Don't bother. I mean, this will control excess urbanization. Although, for the moment, urbanization perhaps is inevitable, and therefore it should be turned into the education center. And any empty houses that might be there due to an overheated real estate market, possibly unrealistically overheated real estate market, every empty house should be turned into a school, yoga school, a massage school, a health center, whatever kind of school it may be. Or it could be an internet or, you know, design center, you know. It could be from the supermodern, the postmodern, and the traditional in combination, not the modern, which is just self-destructive. Also, and my colleague Jirpa Kunle knows this very well, people do need to have fun. And I think one of the reasons a lot of the young like to come to Thimphu is there's more fun here. So, but in a way, the fun that is when you're deracinated from your parents, a little bit might be good to be away from your parents, to some extent, might be fun. But if you're completely away from them and you're living in such a totally different lifestyle that the village comes to seem like a strange place to you, and your place seems strange to the people in the village, that gulf being too much is no good. So there's a rediscovery of the fun of family life, the interrelations within the village and within the craft communities. Someone told me that the other day that the weaving communities used to weave in the open with everyone weaving together and with singing and with a sort of a community life. And now somehow, because of some sort of financial economic pressure on it, they weave it separately and in isolation, and it changes their attitude and their feeling. So now moving to the second part of the talk with a few minutes. Yeah, we have, it's only 40 minutes so far. Are you with me? Okay. Yeah. So now to move to this. This is where I just wanted to run through this, because I've been mentioning this in previous talks again and again as something from the Buddhist side in a different way to interface with the college system here and the high school system, but I never tried to give an example, and I just sort of mentioned it, and I think maybe nobody knew what I was talking about. And so it seems to, you know, the lamas don't change the way they teach Dharma. They just teach the lamas. They don't necessarily think they can teach the lay people. They come for ceremonies, but they can't actually teach them. And they're not trained to do so, which they should be, and which they will be whenever this is understood. It is counterproductive. Now, to come to the Buddhist sciences, I'm coming to that. It is counterproductive, of course, to compare religions unfavorably with each other, since they are matters of faith, not reason. And faith is defined usually as blind faith, not reasonable faith. And so criticizing each other only leads to conflict. When you believe something without a reason, but just because of a tradition or because of an impulse or an intuition, and since you don't have reasons, you can't argue with someone else with reasons, and therefore it turns quickly into conflict. So religion shouldn't be compared like that. So I follow His Holiness the Dalai Lama in saying that Buddhism is best for him, but he doesn't want to say it's best for any other person. And he doesn't want to convert any Christian to Buddhist. He doesn't even want to convert a secularist to Buddhism, you know, a materialist to Buddhism, although that's a philosophical thing, so I wouldn't agree with him completely on that. But he totally wants everybody to stay with their own worldview, but learn from others, and then maybe they modify their worldview within their own tradition. And so he asks the Muslims and the Christians and everyone not to try to convert anybody else, and he tries not to convert anybody. He gives a big speech about how he doesn't want to convert anybody all the time, and he sincerely means it. And then he, you know, when he's about to do that, and when he has given that speech, if I happen to be present, he'll look at me and shake his head sorrowfully and say, "Some people just can't help being Buddhist." I try to reassure him that I wasn't religious before, and therefore Buddhism made me a little spiritual, although maybe still not too religious. But in science, it's a different matter. There is a right and wrong in scientific measurement and in scientific theory. And it's part of the enterprise to compare Einstein and Newton and current practitioners of physics, biology, psychology, etc. One of my colleagues, my fellow pilgrims, is very good on quantum physics. I've been learning from him. So now, something Bhutanese should take cognizance of is their own Buddhist sciences of reality, mind, life, and society. Because Buddhism is very much science. So, and to start this part of it, I start with a picture of the West. Yeah, the West starts with Pythagoras, Euclid, Democritus, Aristotle, comes down through the line, Copernicus, Galileo, Descartes, Newton, Einstein, Heisenberg, etc. These are the prophets of the tradition of science, with the progressive scheme that the more recent are more correct, more realistic than the ancients. But Buddhist science began from a first scientist who claimed to understand reality thoroughly and comprehensively, though, which is, of course, incredible to a modern person who has a built-in idea that no one can understand reality. That's the odd thing about materialist scientists, is that they claim that everybody else is wrong and they're right, and they're about to fit in the last piece of the puzzle of the standard model, for example. They're just about to figure out how the genes deal with it, and then they're about to figure out with neuroscience how your brain does it, and it's all about to happen. And yet, on the other hand, they say, if anybody says, I totally understand how it works, they would say that one is crazy, like give him some Prozac. Like, haul him away. Nobody can understand everything. And when they finish a grant, a $1 billion grant, and build a huge electro and cyclotron in France and Spain and France and Switzerland, and they shoot those atoms around it, and then they go berserk on the international press, we found the Higgs boson. We understand why we have mass. Not just from eating good dinners. We have mass from the Higgs boson. And that's a big triumph and justifies that many $1 billion they spent. But then they right away, at the end of the articles, they say, well, but we still don't quite know how dark matter works, dark energy, and that's 97% of the universe. So, you know, we need another grant. We need a bigger cyclotron. We'll get there, you know. And so they have the theory that you can't understand everything. Therefore, they have a theory there could not be a Buddha. They cannot believe there's such a thing as a Buddha. And in my field, in the academic studies of Buddhism in the West, one of the key things is to try to prove that Buddha was just ordinary. If they could prove that Buddha, like, and one of they thrilled that Buddha was fitting in with the Indian cosmology of the time of Mount Meru and all of this and that, and so, oh, he didn't know the earth was going around the sun, and he's a pre-Copernican, poor simple-minded guy running around his orange toga and pretending he'd been Nirvana, you know. That's their big thing, is to prove. And someone like me, who at least imagines, I don't know if there's a Buddha for sure, because you could only know if there's a Buddha if you are a Buddha. But yet, I've found enough good sense about especially the theory of emptiness, the theory of identity, the way the self works, that really makes good sense that it seems reasonable to me that there is such a thing as higher awareness. And therefore, they think I'm just a fanatic or something, you know. I'm like, maybe I'm a Bhutanese hiding in a weird-looking albino body, who knows? Because that's their industry, is to try to prove that everybody else is just as ordinary as they are. And I wouldn't want everybody to be just as ordinary as myself, actually. At least I reached that point. So, that idea of a first scientist who knew thoroughly everything, and then there is a progressivism, nevertheless, in the tradition. You have then Nagarjuna, you have emergence of Mahayana, you have emergence of Vajrayana, because there's a development of ever better ways to enable other human beings to reach the same understanding. On top of Buddha, now, Western scientists, Eureka, I found the Higgs boson. But of course, you people can't find any Higgs boson. You don't know how to manipulate this kind of machine that you'd probably blow it up if you tried to run it. And also you don't understand the mathematics and all poor regular people. You can only read the New York Times article that I discovered it. So whereas Buddha discovered everything and then he said, and you all can understand everything. Everyone can become enlightened. But it's how to get them to do. Then that's a vast variety of activities and experience. But imagine the difference. I understand what you can verify personally, not just read a paper and listen to my theory. You can verify it personally. In fact, you shouldn't listen to any theory, even what I say, Buddha said, even what I say might be only valid in a certain context for a certain person, and another person needs another theory. So that's a real difference. That's a marvelous real difference between Buddha scientists and other scientists. So both modern and Buddhist scientists traditions agree that knowledge of reality must come from observation of reality and experience of reality. But the modern tradition is kind of imprisoned in the materialist dogma, which they don't realize is a dogma, philosophical dogma. They think it's the end of philosophy. We don't need philosophy anymore. We're measuring everything, and we're watching everything. But they don't realize that when you watch, you predispose what you see by your philosophy or your worldview. But so they haven't caught up with that, but they are just catching up with the Buddhist empiricism about the subtlest planes of reality, dealing with mind, consciousness, subatomic material, micro-reality, the processes of death between state and rebirth, etc., as well as the arts of cultivating higher states of awareness. They're just beginning to... So now let's look at Medicine Buddha, Sanjay Menla, Baisha Juguru. This is a 17th century painting illustrating the Gyushi, the four tantras or technology teachings of which are the medical textbooks of the Bhutanese and Tibetan medicine, the root textbooks. This is part of a 77 painting series set that is actually in medical history. It's the first illustrated medical atlas in medical history before anything the Islamic or the Greco-Roman or the European or the Chinese tradition produced this kind of comprehensive medical atlas. And this is the first painting of that, and it shows the Buddha. When the Buddha looked out and saw the sufferings of the sicknesses of human beings, he turned blue. It affected him so deeply he turned blue into the Medicine Buddha. That the Buddha in the middle there, you can see him. Well, the light is difficult, but he turned blue. And then he's teaching there, and he's living in this city called Sudarshana. While he was teaching, the people had a visionary change, as they often did, a kind of special effect the Buddha used to manifest, where temporarily they saw everything growing in the universe and everything in their world as potentially contributing to health. Even arsenic can be medicine in tiny micro doses. And every plant, which are growing around, there are all kinds of plants and waters and minerals and parts of animal bodies and all sorts of things. The chemistry of nature is such designed to provide health to human beings. And they had a vision. Everyone had that positive vision during the time of his teaching. So now I might skip a few slides to fit this. I'll try to fit this quickly. So Buddha as scientist, his key discovery is that the unenlightened person has the world upside down. Next slide. We think the relative reality is an absolute. We think we are absolute. Our rigid self-identity is really us, and that it opposes a world absolutely other, and therefore we're in this situation of struggling against the world, and we lose that struggle, so we suffer. He investigated this and found that it was just an error. It wasn't any bad scheme of anybody, and that the fixed separate self is an illusion, a reality. We're free of such an absolute self, and our relative self is free of an absolute self, and therefore he found the solution that way. And realizing that, he enjoyed that. He realized his infinite interconnection with all life. He felt that, and the key there is his feeling of freedom from suffering and bliss. He saw that as within the fabric of every other being. He didn't see that, oh, they're not having that. He saw them as really filled with freedom and bliss. Buddha's own vision, which he only revealed in the Mahayana. He kept it a little bit in reserve in the Theravada, the early Nikaya teachings for certain types of male chauvinist Brahmins. He didn't reveal that right away. He let them keep their dualistic idea about Nirvana. But in the non-dualist Mahayana teaching, he revealed that he saw everyone as bliss. That's what made him happy. He would have been happy if he was just happy and the other people were still like, He saw them as really made of bliss. Even their is blissful to him. And then he realized they didn't feel the bliss because they had some concept of And so then the whole job was how to get them out of the into yow, wow, and have them be blown away, which is what nirvana means, to be blown away, and to find the actual bliss. And in fact, in the medicine tradition, the very health of your cells, of the molecules in your body, is held together by bliss. You're made of bliss according to Buddha's vision. But he held that back because some people might misunderstand it, some people might misbelieve it, and other people might think, oh, then I can just do any old thing, doesn't matter. And that way they would have gotten just complacent in their ignorance and in their lack of real bliss. So he, you know, he had his different method with different people. And so his wisdom saw that they were made of bliss, but his compassion made him not ignore that they were trapped in suffering, which then made him manifest universal compassion, or actually he connected with the universal compassion of all Buddhas, and Avalokiteshvara, Chenrezig, and so forth, and his Dharmakaya, Sambhogakaya, Nirmanakaya is still holding us all in a gentle mandala of liberative education. Now, I'm repeating, so I don't have to really do this one, but his discovery of causation, you know, which is a scientific discovery, the famous verse, ye dharma hetu prabhava hetu ntisham tatagata hiyavadat, tisham chayo nirodo, evam vadi mahashramaniye, you know, that the Buddha was celebrated as the discoverer of causation, because connecting to your relational causation within an infinite span, beginningless and endless, makes you responsible to what you do and to how you develop yourself and how you treat others. And that's the pathway to, and an infinite pathway of relationality leads you to Buddhahood. It's the only logical thing to do. If you're stuck in life forever, and death is only a change from life to life, and whether that life improves has to do with what you think, what you do, and what you say, you're bound to think, do, and say things that are a little bit better and not a little bit worse, because it goes out with infinite consequence. And okay, now, main scientific discoveries, and there, I used to put a slide in there, I didn't. You know, the three educations in Buddhism, higher educations, the Adishiksha, the Lakpel Lama Sum. Those three educations are educations. They are not like beliefs. They're education in ethics, education in mind, education in wisdom. The most important of them is education in wisdom. Education in wisdom means gaining knowledge of reality. So you are going to have to, from Buddha's point of view, it's not a matter of just sitting around believing something. You're going to have to understand reality if you want to be happy. And you can understand reality if you have access to the education that the Buddha left, that he's established, you know. And so that's a mention. Then now he discovered, then shunyata, emptiness, is actually a physical theory. It's a scientific theory. Buddha predicted 2,500 years before quantum physics that everything is infinitely divisible. There is no atom. There is no, you know, intrinsically analysis-resistant atom. That matter, mind, whatever it may be, all will dissolve under analysis. And therefore, you know, he discovered in a way what quantum theory is trying to deal with now. He predicted that. That's a scientific prediction, shunyata is. And that shunyata means relativity, that it is the space of relativity, that shunyata is also empty of itself. So it's not like there's some other thing where things dissolve into some sort of nothingness type space. No, emptiness is that all relative things are empty of a non-relative core, and therefore all there is relativity, illusory and dreamlike as it may be, that's all there is. And that discovery he made. So deep reality is beyond conceptual capture. Illusory relative reality is open to hypotheses, explorable by experience experiment, experience superior to inference and belief, although realistic inference is also leads to better experience. The mind's subtle energy more powerful than coarse matter, and wisdom's potential is unlimited as we are deathless. None of us gets to stay dead. Then karma, I already mentioned, so I don't need to do it, is a causal biological theory, 2,400 years ahead of Darwin, rejects any creator. It's not creationism. It rejects creator idea as irrational. Interconnectedness of all species of animals and adding other animals that the materialist thinks don't exist because they don't see them. More accepting of relativity, not nihilistic, because person's relative soul is part of it. Soul meaning only a changing continuum of the super subtle mind. It doesn't mean something fixed that never changes of a person. There is no such thing. Mind creates the brain rather than brain, and brain is merely an instrument of the mind rather than the brain creates the mind. And ethics causes humanity, generosity causes wealth, patience causes beauty, and compassion causes bliss. Then his depth psychology was really cool. He found all the evil unconscious drives, but he dealt with them. You know, Buddha's rejection of, or his transcendence of Freud really is exemplified in the Tanka of the Kalachakra Buddha, which some of you may be familiar with, because one of his feet is, and the Universal Mother's feet together, is planted on Kama, Mara, the deity of lust, and that's Eros, you know, that's Freud's Eros, and one of them is planted on Rudra, which is the fierce form of, before Shiva is nice and peaceful, but it's the nasty form, and that is Thanatos, you know, Freud's famous Eros and Thanatos. And they're under the feet of the Wheel of Time Buddha, of Buddha when he shows his body as the Wheel of Time. And that's it, you know, that's all. And then we get into the death business, the psychonaut, you know, the Book of the Dead, but you all know about that, the natural liberation, the Bardo Tudor, and the super subtle mind, and how the spiritual gene interacts with the physical genes. That's a thing that you have in most refined Buddhist Abhidharma, Buddhist science. And the point is that the young people, this 22-year-old average age, under 25, 54% of your people, have gone to college where they learn science as Western science as if that's the last word. And it is not the last word. It is actually delusory. All you have to remember is, like I can tell you an anecdote of my encounter with a famous neuroscientist in a hospital in New York who wanted to put, fMRI, magnetic resonance imaging machines on different yogis. And I suggested he best try those who can simulate the death experience and leave their body, who are into advanced Dzogrim and Dzogchen practices, and very close to the death experience. And that would be really interesting for him, I told him. He said, "Don't ever say that. We know there's nothing after death. We've proven that." I said, "How did you prove it?" He said, "I put dead body in my fMRI, and there was nothing happening in that brain." Well, of course, I said. Well, I didn't say anything. I was trying to be polite. So I said, "Okay, I'll never mention it again." And then only a day or two later, it was so vehement, we know there's nothing after death. We've proven it. He was so vehement, I was sort of intimidated and going around on tiptoes for a day or so. And then I suddenly realized that this man, who's like a Nobel Prize candidate, famous neuroscientist, slaughtered a lot of monkeys in his lab, put a lot of yogis in fMRI machines, done a lot of stuff that's very important, runs around believing that he has discovered nothing. And that he's proven the existence of nothing. But that's an incoherent thing to think. Nothing is exactly nothing. And it is not there. And you can't get there. As I like to say when I give talks on the Book of the Dead, nobody gets out of here a dead. You can die, and then you just have to make a new body of some kind, and it will be made by whatever you're made of, what your mind is made of. And you don't stay dead. No way. You don't get out of it all by dying. There's no absolute state of death at all. It's just a transition point, like going through a door. And that means quality of life becomes vitally important at a different level of intensity. There's no more reckless, like, be here now, what the heck, who cares? That's not viable when you realize that your consequences of the way you are, even what you think, even if you're not doing anything special, will go on with you forever. And therefore, the only decent way to be forever is to be a Buddha, because they do have more fun. Buddhas do. I know that's a shocking thing to say in a traditional society. But, those Buddhas, those yabyums up there, they're not just like, painting there. They're having more fun than the regular people, because they're in love with everyone in the universe. And they are simple bliss. That's what they are. They don't have to be sitting in yabyum. They can be across the room and they're still feeling in bliss. But that's what it's saying, those paintings. So anyway, I don't need the last couple of conclusion slides because they're not mentioning it. But the reason I wanted to exemplify that is that the science, Buddhism, not only as a faith, and not only to go and be kind and believe in the lamas and go to the temple and do that for the young lay people, since they are being educated in a Western materialist educational matrix, they need to encounter the scientific insights of Buddhism, Buddhism's scientific challenges to the material sciences. It's actually very good that they learn the material sciences, of course, because they have a lot to do with the way things are done in the planet right now. But that they develop a different way of challenging them, and challenging especially the dogma of nihilistic materialism, which is really totally depressing, actually, to people, and leads to the reckless behavior of industrial culture. I don't even say civilization. I consider the industrial culture on this planet a kind of savagery, a savagery where greed, the poison of greed, you know, is magnified into consumerism and polluting industrialization for consumer useless products. And the poison of hatred is magnified by industrialization into nuclear militarism, poison biological warfare, poison gas warfare, nuclear warfare, militarism, terrorist type of warfare. And so those are the two poisons that are magnified. And delusion is magnified by Harvard University and Columbia University. And the whole science-dominated, you know, materialism, science-dominated educational institutions that support these industrializations. In fact, that's the magnification of delusion. And it's time, and if anybody can resist that, and if anybody can set an example to these things, it should be you, the Bhutanese. You didn't get dumped on by a bunch of communists to reform your mind into materialism, which they got all brainwashed and beaten up about materialism. And the capitalists don't completely own you 100% yet. But if you don't do this, they will. You know, they will invest, you'll be 3% partner and they'll be 97% partner in every kind of extractive industry they can possibly think of. There are some Indian lumber companies who are drooling over your 60% timber coverage. Drooling, simply drooling over it. They drive through that and say, how can there be so many trees on this hillside that are not in my mill? Etc., you know. I won't go on in that direction. It's up to you guys. But anyway, it's in a way, you know, and Khyentse Rinpoche and Gyantse Tulku, and especially Khyentse Rinpoche, who's had so much more exposure to the Western thing, I really look to him for the leadership here. I'm so proud of him trying to translate. For example, when I met with him, and you know, I already, myself, I'm just a poor slob struggling along. I was ordered by my root teacher, an old Mongolian, and the Dalai Lama to translate the Tenjor when I got my PhD. Thanks a lot. No chance for a golf game or a tennis match. Translate the Tenjor is hopeless. And then they, oh, not in one life, oh, two, three lives. Oh, thanks. It's like they're giving me a work program for lifetimes. So then Khyentse Rinpoche comes along. What a wonderful thing. He says, well, he's trying to be polite. He says, we'll do Kanjor. You know, the spirit, the religious text, not the more boring philosophical text. Well, that was sort of division of labor. That was nice. But the motive was so beautiful. My young Bhutanese, he was saying, and I said, and you can add in a lot of Tibetans in either in exile or in China, but especially in exile where the English language is important. My, not only Westerners, but my young Bhutanese will probably not learn to read Chöge. And they will only encounter Buddha's presence in the sutras through English language translation. And therefore, there should be correct and good and accurate one and not distorted one. And so they will read that, you know, they will, Damchup Pema Karpo, oh, that's Chöge. But then they come to the White Lotus Sutra that people read all over Japan and all over, and a lot of people in the West now and in Australia and all over, and then underground in communist China, they're totally gaga about Buddhism, in fact. Because that materialism never satisfies because it's utterly irrational. I like to say, please remember this one statement. The worst form of blind faith is to believe in nothingness. That's the worst blind faith because there, in principle, can never be evidence for the existence of nothingness. So that you will become nothing and don't have to worry about your future life is the worst kind of blind faith. The most irrational. It's better to believe in God running around up there trying to send you down like some sort of a, give you a nice holiday in heaven singing in the choir or something. That's more logical than nothing. And yet that nothing is what the majority of the elite of industrial society do believe in, actually, as their reality that faces them. Okay, thank you. That's enough.